Yes. Welcome back after the break. Was Diksha was talking, speaking?
Yes, I have one question actually.
Please go ahead.
So about the assignment, we have to fill up in online also.
Oh, no, you don't have to.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, I had posted it for to all of you because then I can enter your marks manually.
Okay.
That helps, yeah. Because you're already written, you did an in-person exam, you don't have to do it online, no. Okay, Asapu, you had something to say, or Diksha wanted to speak.
No, ma'am. It was about assignment only.
Okay, the assessment. Okay,
Yeah,
fine.
thank you.
Yeah. I was just thinking because we have so many, we have to learn or read through so many great men and women of God who, birth the revivals and the moves of God. I was just thinking if, to make the class more engaging and interesting, and rather than you all just listening to my voice all the time, I was just thinking that if I can assign each of you two or three specific people mentioned here or revivals that were birthed, and so you all during the class time you all can do the teaching, and then I can grade you based on the your content, your presentation, the learning that we can receive, and mark it on for 15 marks. What do y'all think? I think that's a good way to make the class more engaging and exciting, right? And also it will help you all to read, to analyze, to share your thoughts. What do y'all think? Can I have some suggestions, please?
Sister, we can write and this, but presentation, I'm not sure whether I can do it.
Why, Sister Gertrude, you speak every time in your, and you speak, you share, so your
I mean, the computer, you have to do it, the presentation, right? Means, show it to the class.
No. I'm not going to ask you all to show a PowerPoint and all. I know that can be too, stressing, because if it doesn't work, then how are you going to, handle that? No, I just want you to the content that is there. I will just like, for example, now I spoke about Henry Martin, Robert Morrison, and Adoniram Judson, and I will just give like these three missionaries for one person. You just share what is there in the notes, and what are the learnings, what we can learn, and what really ministered and catered to you. I think that's
Yeah,
very
sister, we
simple.
can do that. Yeah,
Yeah, and
we
I
can
think
do
that'd be
that.
quite engaging and interesting, right?
Yeah.
Fine. Yeah, thank you, Lucy. Thank you, Gertrude. I think there was Angeline. Yes, thank you. Yeah, Miriam. Okay, I think this is going to be exciting. So you're not just really listening to my voice.
Ma'am,
Thank you, John. Yes, Asapu. Thank you, Sam
ma'am,
Daniel.
this is for in-class students also. Like,
Yes,
can you please repeat
everyone.
what the assignment, ma'am? Like,
Sorry.
can you just repeat the assignment?
Okay. So this is from next week onwards. I'll come whatever portion I complete, then from there on I will assign people online and in person. You don't have to put your if you can put your videos on, it's fine. I understand if you put your videos on, for some of you it'll be very challenging with the internet connectivity. So you can just put your mics on and you can just share the missionaries or the move of God, the revival that was birthed, the portion that is given to you, states the facts that are there. If you can read up a little more, it's good. And also you can give us a little background, that is also good. And what can we learn from this missionary or this revival that was birthed in this place? Okay. All of you who are not able to do it next week, I understand. But what I do is I will just plan a schedule. I will run it past all of you. And if some of you are, you know, traveling, away on work, are online students, and you want to swap, we can do that. But, you know, those of you who are okay, you can just go ahead as per the plan. The marks will be, you know, I'm thinking 15 as of now, but I can also, you know, I need to work on that. But your presentation, you don't have to do a PowerPoint. I understand that's going to be a little difficult and can be stressful for you all to present and all that if you don't know the technicalities that are involved. So we leave that out. Just your presentation style, the content that you are giving, you know, the content that you are presenting or you're sharing, and what is the learning that we can receive and what impacted you and what can impact us in our world today, and, you know, and how God can move. Okay. So, and the extra content, if you also bringing in, that is also fine. So all that will be graded, and then I will just give you the marks for that. So we'll do that next week, starting next week. Is that fine, right, for all of you? I think that'll be... duration. Yes, I was thinking I missed out on something. So the duration, I think we'll keep it to maximum 10 minutes. You know, not more than 10 minutes. If you finish within 7 to 8 minutes, that's also fine. Okay. Even if you finish in a shorter time, but the content is what you're getting the marks for, and the way you're presenting it, what is the learning, what we receive is what we are getting to learn. Okay, I think we should have, I was thinking of this for quite a number of weeks, but finally decided to do it now. Okay, fine, we'll continue. Okay, thank you everyone for your cooperation on that. That seems very exciting. Okay, we'll move on to Robert Moff, who is the father of Protestant African missions. He was basically a Scottish missionary to Africa, was very effective in reaching the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ in the Botswana land. And he translated the whole of the Bible and the, you know, the Pilgrim's Progress in Swetswana. And what an amazing work he's done in just, you know, translating the Bible in their language and, you know, giving it to this people in Africa. Then in 1819, it was Dr. John Scudder. He was an American physician, and he was an evangelist in Sri Lanka and India. So in 1890, he moved from New York to Sri Lanka, and he was the first medical missionary of the American Board of Commissioners for Foreign Missions there. He engaged in, you know, evangelism work, also, you know, in ministering in the hospital, in the day and boarding schools, also, you know, training of medical students among the Tamilians who are living in Jaffna. And in 1836, he was transferred to Madras, and he was there for 6 years. He was practicing medicine. He was a doctor, and he was also preaching, and he learned Tamil, and he published many tracts in Tamil and English. And it is said that, you know, he would stand for 11 hours at a time just preaching and distributing literature. And the amazing legacy that he has left, you know, is that four generations of his family where missionaries, almost 42 missionaries from four generations of his family, came up as missionaries, including Ida Scudder, who started CMC Medical College and hospital in Vellore, so very famous in India and all world over. And also, they contributed to over 1,000 years of missionary service. Just amazing, just one man and his family and four generations, coming up with 42 missionaries and contributing to over 1,000 years of missionary service, and starting a Christian Medical College in Vellore. So this is someone who has left a legacy, a family legacy. Just amazing the work of God that this family has done as missionaries. And then we come to 1830 to 1840, which is the General Awakening, or the Third Great Awakening. Now, why do we call this as the Great Awakening? Anyone knows what is the meaning of Great Awakening? What's the meaning of Great Awakening?
Is it Great Revival, ma'am?
Okay, so yes, several periods of religious revival, yes. What else? What else did we see in this awakening? In the last two that we studied, the first and the second. Apart from the religious revival, what else was happening?
Transformation, ma'am?
Yes, social transformation. Thank you, Akhil. So we see that, the Great Awakening basically refers to periods of religious revival in American Christian history. So it's called the Great Awakening because these movements basically brought a widespread, spiritual renewal and social transformation. It was an awakening of people to a deeper sense of religious conviction, personal faith, and the need for moral reform. So I think it's so much more a need of a Great Awakening in our present day scenario and situations. There were typically four great awakenings that were recognized, and each occurred in different centuries. The first two were particularly very, very influential. Now, the key reasons why we call this as the awakening was because it was there was spiritual renewal that happens. Periods were characterized by a renewed focus of personal faith, repentance, and spiritual fervor, and a great multitude of people just converting, many of them recommitting their lives to Christ. And there was a great membership that was happening in the churches. And there was also mass conversion. It was also called awakening because there was mass conversions that were happening and revival meetings. So the preaching during this awakenings was so powerful that it just kind of stirred up people and brought in a very strong emotional response, which led to mass conversions, and these revival meetings drew just crowds of people, sometimes in thousands, came from not only the city, but different parts of that country and the countries around, and they basically experienced intense spiritual awakenings. Also, these great awakenings often challenged the religious institutionalized kind of form of religion that was there and in the church, and it was just promoting more a personal, intimate, personal, deep relationship and connect with and fellowship with God. So we see that it was kind of an opposition to the more formal and traditional practices that were happening. And of course, you know, like we saw that there was a great social and cultural impact that was happening. It had a profound impact on an effect on the social political landscape, and it promoted ideas like, you know, religious freedom, you know, moral reform, and also abolition of slavery and other movements that started. So, you know, when we as a church today can rise up to pray, to intercede, you know, we can come to a place where there can be abolition of, you know, you know, of pornography, of slave trade, of prostitution that is happening, you know, and rape and all of those things, you know, which we can stop, we can pray towards, and there can just be such a powerful move of God. So we saw the first great awakening, the 1730s to the 1740s, and it was, we saw Jonathan Edwards and George Whitefield, you know, and so, you know, and it was awakening because it, you know, it in the sense that people were spiritually woken up to the religious degradation, moral degradation, and the spiritual lethargy and dullness and the complacency that, you know, that people were in. Okay, now 1830 to 1840 is the general awakening, or it's called the third great awakening. During this period, the second great awakening continued in America till the 1810, and then, you know, we see that, you know, there was a rise of the third great awakening that happened in the 1830s, and just to mention a few things, and, you know, then we look into deeper into people who rose up during this great awakenings and what they did. So Charles Finney was a person, you know, who came up and and, you know, who birthed a revival. And it is said that, you know, that in that 1 year in 1830, about 1 lakh people, you know, were added to the church, okay, in America. And similar revivals that happened in Great Britain, there was a revival that happened in the Methodist congregation, the Methodist groups. There was also revival that happened in Wales, both in the north and south, in Scotland, and you know, in Ireland, there was a powerful revival that people experienced, and it was called as the Second Reformation, because that there was a reformation that happened earlier. We spoke about that, that happened in Ireland, but this is the Second Reformation. And during this time, also the Christian Brethren denomination began. It was started by John Nelson. And in Europe, you know, those who experienced a second great awakening, they became carriers of revival during this third great awakening. We look at the various people, we'll study them. And one of them was, you know, George Scout, who was a British Methodist evangelist in Sweden, and he kind of trained many people, and they caught on the revival fire and they took the revival fire to Switzerland, France, Holland. So we see that even though there was revival that happened in the first and the second great awakening in these places, still we see, you know, they're going back into spiritual lethargy, dullness, and there has to be another move of God, a revival. So, you know, there was revival fires that happened all over these places. There was also revival that happened in Germany, Norway, and missionaries, you know, were excited, were ignited with this revival fire, and they carried this revival to other regions as well. We see that during this time, there was also great revival that happened in Hawaii, in Australia, South Africa, Cape Town in South Africa, the Botswana land in Africa, in Asia, Middle East, China, and Burma. Okay, so we'll just look at a few people who carried these revival fires to these various places. So in 1830, we have Charles Finney, who is the father of modern revivalism. He accepted Christ at the age of 29, and he became a very successful evangelist. He was basically, you know, a lawyer. And he was very, very a hardcore atheist, but God touched him, changed him, and look at the change that happened. You know, he started a revival, and his revival was, you know, strongly emphasized by this whole idea that, you know, there was human responsibility before God, even as he called people to renew their obedience to God. So he says in salvation, there is, you know, a human responsibility, and he strongly emphasized that. That means we need to take that step of faith and accept Christ. And also, you know, there's human responsibility involved in working out our salvation. With people are called to renew their obedience to their Lord. And we see that Charles Finney, he preached, and even as when he preached, you know, he people manifested. They were squirming, moving, weeping, and many of them actually criticized this move of God because it was not very, very, you know, these things that were happening was not something that was a norm that was there. So they said that he used some new measures and new techniques for evangelism. They said it was his techniques were manipulative, and you know, they criticized him because all of this was not happening, had not been done before. So what was he doing? He was basically, when he was preaching and teaching, he would give a public invitation, like an altar call, like, you know, we give these days, right? An altar call for people to come up in front if they've accepted the Lord Jesus Christ, or to raise their hand. So this was not something that was followed then. And he started something like this because he felt that, hey, when God moves, when God is working in our lives, we also have to take the human beings have to take the responsibility to respond to God and to respond in obedience. So he started in his meetings, in his teaching, you know, that or the church services where I was preaching, inviting people who have accepted the Lord, who want to obey him, who want to turn away from their sins, to come up in the front, you know, receive, you know, the Lord Jesus, and those who want to receive the Lord Jesus as the Lord and Savior. And also he had something called the anxious seats, you know, several rows in the church were reserved for those who, you know, felt convicted of their sin, you know, some of them who were backslidden, some of them who gone away from God. When they're convicted, you know, they could come and sit in these rows and, you know, while he was preaching. So it was like a response, their response to God's call, to God's move, and what God was working in their lives. And this, you know, it's something that some churches do today. We also we have the, you know, altar call, and, you know, ask people if they want to accept Christ to stand up or raise their hand. But it was something that was not done before, and so he was criticized and saying that his approach is very manipulative. Okay. But one of the most remarkable things that happened in Charles Finney's life was, you know, a revival that took place during the 6 months in when he was in New York in 1830. There was amazing move of God, the work of God, the manifestation of the Holy Spirit. There was healing, there was reconciliation that took place, you know, among the churches, the Presbyterian churches, and other denominations as well. And by the end of this Rochester revival, Rochester is a place in New York, you know, every lawyer, doctor, and businessman in the town was saved. Imagine. That is what we call as revival, right? Where there is healing, there's reconciliation, there's a move of God, and, you know, thousands are just in every field, every area of life, walk of life, you know, are accepting the Lord. So such a powerful revival that every lawyer, doctor, and businessman were saved, and many people were convicted of their sin. Also, there was a move of God in the local high school. Entire student body were convicted of their sins, and the principal did not know how to handle it. She called Charles Finney for help, and, you know, 40 students were converted that day. Okay, so it is, you know, in this Rochester revival that was sparked, the revival fire that was sparked, it spread in 1,500 towns and villages across New England, and thousands were converted and entire communities were transformed through this ministry. So this was like a powerful revival and a powerful move of God. And during this time, it's very nice to see, you know, many men and women became prayer partners with Finney to undergird his ministry in prayer. And I think that is so important. So when we see God is birthing a revival somewhere, you know, we might not be part of that revival. We might not be part of, you know, we might not be there in that location, geographical location, but what we can do as a church, as a larger body of Christ, the worldwide body of Christ, is to support these revivals, these moves of God, so that, you know, it will cause such a great impact. It will cause such a revival fire that will spread out. You know, sometimes these revivals that have happened, sadly, if you look at the history of some of the revivals, there's a great move of God, but it was not being able to be sustained because the leader fell, or, you know, into some moral issues or some financial thing or something happened. So when there is a great move of God, it's important that we can learn here is that as a worldwide body of Christ, the Church of Christ, we need to pray and support you know, the revival that is happening, praying that, you know, there will just be such a this revival will spread across, that, you know, things will fall in place, that you know, the enemy will not come and destroy what was started through the lives of the leaders. The leaders, we need to soak them in prayer, you know, so that they will be able to steward this movement, steward this revival in a powerful way, in a God-honoring way, so that it will not bring a downfall, but will continue to, you know, spread like a wild fire. So you can remember this, you know. Sometimes our response is, oh, there's a revival happening there, exciting. We just look at it, YouTube, or watch it. But, you know, we have a responsibility as well. We need to pray towards what is happening there, support the revival, pray for the leaders so that there's a powerful move that continues and there is no downfall or, you know, anything that is that happens that will bring an end to that revival, but will continue to move. Okay, so these prayer partners, they would just not pray for Charles Finney and his ministry, but they would go into cities and spend their time praying for the people whom Finney is going to minister. Imagine. You know, we don't know their names. We only know, we read only about Charles Finney, but some of the names are here, like Abel and you know, but there are so many others who went out into these cities just praying, you know, for the people there before Firi would go and minister. Okay, so that's another powerful thing that we can do as a church as well. You know, if we are as a church, your church is trying to start churches elsewhere, plant churches elsewhere, minister in different towns and cities, or you're going to have a youth camp or your a revival campaign or whatever. It's important as a church to pray. You know, in Bangalore, a couple of years back, we had this pastor come who's leading you know, the biggest church here in India. You know, he came to talk about you know, church mission strategies and all of those things. So just hearing him out was wonderful. I like what he said. He said, you know, two things that he said, you know, is kind of stuck in my mind. He says that as a church, you know, the first 6 months of the year, they pray. They just fast and pray for the rest of the 6 months of the year that they're going to engage in mission work or evangelistic moves or the evangelistic campaigns that they're going to have across the city, their city, or in the country of India. And I thought that was such a powerful model, because that is what God wants us to do, you know, before we engage in missions or establishing churches or, you know, having some campaigns or some programs. So important to pray. So first 6 months of the year, the church really prays for the rest of the 6 months that they are going to involve in evangelistic and mission work. And the other thing that he said was, he, you know, as a pastor, God has called him to pastor that church which God has entrusted to him. So he says it's important for him to feed his sheep and not leave his sheep to be fed by other people. So he says he takes on preaching assignments during the weekdays and not on Sunday, because on Sunday, he says, he is, you know, the father of the church, and it is his responsibility to feed his children. He says, like, you know, my wife and my children, nobody will feed them. I have to feed them, right? So the same way, he says, I have to feed my church, and I can't feed them, you know, stale food or leave them to the care of others to take care of my church, but I have to feed my church, my sheep, the people God has entrusted to me. So he says that he's, you know, he's always there in his church. He says hardly one or twice a year he's not there on the Sundays, but the rest of the Sundays he's there just ministering. And he says, you know, he spends quality time on preparing the message, sometimes a whole night on Saturdays, just preparing the message to preach on Sunday. So I said, no doubt, you know, he has the biggest church in our country, and just how God is moving him, because he's got things in place, you know, the right strategies to move, and how God is extending his church and moving him. So I think it's important that, you know, we go out and minister, but it's important also to have the right strategies in place, because God is more interested in not how much we do, but God is more interested in our character. He's interested more in how much time we spend with him, the relationship that we build in him, our intimacy with him. And, you know, when that is strong, you know, he does the rest. Like Jesus is an example, right? Jesus spent quality time with the Father, was very intimate with the Father. The next morning, he just knows where to go, who to minister to, what to say, what not to do. You know, it was like an itinerary just coming down, a download from heaven. So it's important, even as God has called us into ministry, that we follow the right strategies so that we can be effective ministers. So here we see, you know, you know, also partner with people in the ministry. Okay. So that was Charles Finney, and some, you know, valuable lessons that we can learn from his life, and also, you know, the people associated in his life. We'll move on. Any questions so far? Anything anyone wants to say?
Ma'am, just one small query.
Yes.
This is with regard to the altar call that you were referring to. I've heard Billy Graham, you know, preach many, many times where he usually says, you know, towards the end he calls like the altar call, and he quotes a verse where he says, like, if you're ashamed to come here in the presence of men, God will be ashamed, Jesus will be ashamed of you when you are in the heaven. Correct? So sometimes in these days, we don't usually see altar calls. We actually see either people raising in the hands or things. So what's the ideal thing to do, ma'am?
I think it's not like we have, you know, the churches are no more asking, you know, calling for altar calls. I think that still happens in some places, especially when we have, you know, crusades or campaigns or, you know, youth camps, or you know, to come up in front so that we can pray for them and minister and all of those things. But in church services, you know, sometimes, yeah, we see that happening. But, you know, raising up of hands so that people are not, you know, ashamed, or they're scared or they're shy or whatever, to just give them that kind of a freedom, I think, so that they're comfortable in their place. Even raising up their hand, yes, calls for a lot of, you know, courage and boldness, but at least that step is there. And then later on, you know, telling them to meet up and, you know, with the people and who can help them to grow in the ways of the Lord. So it's happening in a few churches, but in other places, yes, there's a raising of hands.
So in that scenario, am I, as a pastor, for example, being skeptical and thinking, will people feel ashamed to lift? So I try to diplomatically tell them, close your eyes, and then only the ones who want to think, raise the hands. So in that way, am I being a little safeguarded, disturbing on the thing? So the query was with regard to in a large forum, more than churches, no? Like when it's a public forum. So when Billy Graham did, it was just no second thought. It was just very crystal clear. So what's your thoughts on that, ma'am?
I think we can follow the same, you know, just come up in front, you know, take that bold stand, you know, that you have committed your life to the Lord. There's nothing to be ashamed about. There's nothing to be fearful about. That's something that is testifying about God's work, His goodness, His power. It's also going to encourage others as well to see, oh, God saved this person's life, so powerful, so wonderful, and, you know, you know, rejoicing with the heavenly host in what God is doing. I would love, you know, altar calls. Just people coming up, and if, you know, people don't want to come up, also if they want to just wherever they are standing, they want to raise their hands, find people around them can pray for them as well, that can also be done. Yeah, but I would love altar call. Yes, that's an old traditional way, but yes, it's nice, good. What about the others? Anyone would like to share your thoughts on this?
Sister, say only in the crusade and the public meeting this can happen, altar call. But in regular churches, sister, a pastor knows all the people unless some newcomers come for the first time. So it doesn't happen in the churches, the prayer meeting or anything, but it happens in crusade most of the time.
I've seen that happening in our Methodist church. I've seen it happen. You know, the altar call, people coming up in front. Yes, it's kind of just motivates. When one steps out, many after that step out and come. I also see this in youth camps. It happens in youth camps as well, children's camps, you know. So just one person steps out and then the others are encouraged and come. And so it's just good to see, you know, how God is working, how God is moving, just to glorify God, just to know who have come up and, you know, testified and how God has touched them, how as a church we can support them, right? How we can encourage them, how we can build them up, pray for them. So, you know, somebody, you identify somebody, you can say, hey, this person is so happy, so excited. Maybe you were praying for them, their parents were praying for them. Then you can, you know, as an elder in the church, somebody is a strong, mature believer, you can take on the responsibility. So that really helps us in altar call, where you're able to see, identify, support, build them up. You know, it's good.
Yes, sister.
Yeah. Did that help, Akhil?
Certainly, yes, ma'am. Thank you.
Yeah. But we can also, you know, bring in variations like in children's church, you know, when you minister, I would say anyone wants to come out and, you know, accept the Lord Jesus Christ, and then nobody comes. Okay, then you are shy, then you want to raise up your hand, and we'll have, you know, one or two children slowly raise up their hands, because, you know, especially among the older kids, there is this whole identity about peer group identity. They don't want to be made fun of and all of those things. So that time we be a little more, sensitive, understanding. And then you just know, you can tell others, you please close your eyes, everybody. So those of them who want to really commit, you can commit. And then, you know who are the children, and then you can work with them. The teachers and, you know, the person who's leading the Sunday school can minister to them. So that also works in smaller settings. Yeah.
Correct, ma'am. But just having this a small comment without taking mm-hmm. a name of a community, why I feel a little burdened is, as Christians, we know about the living God, we serve the living God and we worship. But when it comes to public forum, recently I heard a preacher say, sometimes we are so diplomatic, we will say, God is there, God is there. The word Jesus doesn't come. But for some other communities, without taking their names, they from the younger age, on an average age of around 4-5 years till a long age, they keep telling the name without any hesitation in public. So yes. That's the whole thought process.
Yes, you're very true. I also agree with what you say. Yes. I mean, they just don't hesitate to, whether they have in their YouTube channels or whether they are celebrities and they are, speaking in a talk show. They just don't, hesitate taking the name of their God. But for us, yes, we are so hesitant. We are so diplomatic. We're so careful. But also it is important that the time and age that we are in, that we are a little more careful so that we don't lose the opportunity to minister. For example, now we are ministering in schools, right, in Bangalore City, and we started our school outreach ministry of APC in schools, and we started it as scripture classes. So we were teaching all the Bible stories and talking about sin, salvation, Jesus, Holy Spirit, gifts of the Spirit, everything. But then, when this anti-conversion bill was passed, we are not able to take scripture to schools. The schools were not taking us in, so we started life skills built on biblical principles, with which we are very straightforward with the principles. Life skills built on biblical principles, and we also will use Bible narratives. So they say, no, you can't use Bible narratives. So we tell them, hey, most of the parables that are given in these moral lessons in the school textbooks are taken from the Bible, right? So when we go into these schools, we are teaching them, but we use God, we don't use Jesus. But of course, when we start and end with prayer, we say in Jesus' name. Why are we being a little diplomatic there? Is because we don't want to lose the opportunity, right? Some children have gone and complained to their parents. They've come and told this one that, you can't have all of these things. So instead of losing the opportunity, yes, we use the name of God, but there are some situations, there are some points where we cannot say God, we need to say Jesus. So that's when we just, speak the name. And children are able to now identify that when we are talking about God, that when we are talking about salvation, we're talking about healing, we're talking about answers to prayer, that no one else can give them those answers other than them praying to Jesus. So there are some times when we need to not compromise on our stand of important things, but there are times when we should be also a little careful so that we don't lose the opportunity. If we are not careful, we will lose the opportunity of just this wide audience that we have, that we can reach out to, that we can minister to, just by being a little foolish. So yes, we have to be a little diplomatic at times, but also, you know, when and where we just have to speak. God gives us the wisdom and he moves, and children are able to experience him and, you know, see the move of God. Yes. And God will do his work. That's the work of the Holy Spirit, to transform lives. We are just faithful with what he has given to us. Yeah, so we talk about sin, salvation. There is no other name in which they can receive salvation, and all of that is very, you know, told very straightforward. Yes. So, does that help, Akhil?
Yes, ma'am. Because we need to have that clarity as Christians to know, to really use without shying away. Thank you.
So I think what you're saying is, even in shying away, when you're talking about the other religion, what you're mentioning is they are not more evangelistic in their approach, like Christians are known for evangelizing. They are not evangelistic.
Correct.
Whenever they say it, it's taken lightly. But when we Christians, when we say things, they look at it as very evangelistic because of all that we are studying in history, right? Mm. Everywhere they went, it was not only just sharing the gospel, leading people to Christ, but also so many other things. So the main focus was what? Evangelizing. Along with that, they did various other things, and various other things is translating the Bible, which we don't see that happening in other, I won't mention, but you understand, you know.
Correct. I get you.
Yeah, so evangelizing is something that is foremost in the Christian circles, in the Christian world, and that is kind of being a threat to other people. So anything and everything that you say, even if it's just a one-line statement, it's taken as evangelizing because of the history that is backing it up.
Got you, ma'am. Got you.
Yeah. Okay. I think that was something that just came from above. Okay, trying to understand what. Okay, we just have two more minutes. Anyone has any questions? We'll not move to Edward Iring. Okay, just in 2 minutes, anyone would like to share something that you learned in today's class, something that really impacted you? Quickly, please. One or two things. Some takeaway from today's class.
Sister, these missionaries were very passionate about serving the Lord, and they went extreme in their missionary work, even to the point of death.
Mm-hmm. Yes, being so passionate. Thank you, Gertrude. Anyone else? Any takeaways for y'all? I'm sure there's so many takeaways. Please share one or two more. You have 1 minute. Okay, that was a sad response, but thank you for Gertrude. Thank you, Gertrude. Okay, thank you everyone for joining class today. I will post, what each one of you have to share on, and I hope that will be exciting for us and a good learning experience, and I can also learn from all of you. Thank you, everyone. Have a blessed day. God bless. Thank you. Lucy, what happened? You didn't speak up today, Lucy. Didn't hear your voice.
Little bit of fineness.
Okay. Take care. Thank you. Thank you, everyone.